Welcome to Omogi. Omogi was excavated in the 1930s. It is the largest archaeological dig in the United States. We found over 2 million artifacts here, and we're still sorting through them today. From the artifacts we've gone through, we discovered that we had Native Americans who lived here for over 17,000 years. It was what we call the Paleo-Indian period. These people migrated from Siberia across the Bering Strait into Alaska, then down into Canada, and then they came into the United States. When they got into the United States, a group branched off and came down here. The majority of the rest kept migrating down to Mexico, Central America, and South America. These people were wandering nomadics who lived off the land. During the Ice Age, the animal of choice was the woolly mammoth and the saber-toothed tiger and the giant sloth. Now, as you notice, there's a broken spear point in the display case. That is the oldest artifact we found to date. The person who found it in the 1930s, he found it in a fire pit. But when he put it in the collection bag, he also picked up a piece of charcoal from the fire pit and put it in the collection bag with it. So in the 1950s, when we developed the carbon dating process, then they were able to carbon date the charcoal, and then that was one of the clues that gave us the time period that these people were here. And then about 11,000 years ago, the Ice Age ended. The descendants of these original people were still migratory, but they tended to migrate up and down the Omogi River, which is just below the park here. Omogi is Native American for bubbling water, because at the headwater of the river, which is about 60 miles north of us, the water bubbles out of the ground from an underground aquifer, and it starts the river process. And then it flows to our coast, the coast of Georgia, at a little town called Darien, which is just north of Brunswick or south of Savannah. And these people would migrate up and down the river in search of game or vegetation that was available to them depending on the season. Moving on to our next period, about 3,000 years ago, the weather finally stabilized as we know it today. The population of these people had now grown to the point that they started establishing villages. They started doing limited horticulture, planting sunflower seeds and other things that would give them something to eat on a regular basis. The bow and arrow was invented in North America during this time period. But the most important thing of this time period was the invention of pottery. Because prior to the invention of pottery, the way you cooked your food was you dug a hole in the ground, you laid an animal skin in the hole, you put your food and water on the animal skin, and you took rocks and you put them in the fire to heat them up. When the rocks got good and hot, you picked them up with a stick and dropped them into your food and stirred them around. What we call boiling stones. We had a group come out of the West, we called the Mississippians. Now the Mississippians reigned from Illinois all the way down to New Orleans on the east side of the Mississippi River. And they were the farmers. They brought in the beans, the corn, the squash, tobacco, pumpkins. But they also had a very structured civil system, political system, and religious system. And they're the people who built the mounds you see here today. They built mounds from Illinois all the way down to Florida. And they lived well until the year 1540 here, until the Spanish conquistador Hernando de Soto came to town. And then it went downhill from there. Not only was Mr. de Soto not a nice person to the Native Americans, but the Spaniards brought diseases the Native Americans had no natural immunities. So when they contracted the disease, it went epidemic in their villages and they lost 50 to 75% of their people. But they survived, and they survived him, and they finally got Mr. de Soto about 4 years later on the Mississippi River. And then they went back to life as they knew it. And then in the early 1700s, James Oglethorpe came and established the colony of Georgia, which was about 200 years after the defeat of de Soto. Now, General Oglethorpe treated the Native Americans as equals. He helped them establish farms. When they had problems, he helped them with their problems. When he had problems, they in turn helped him with his problems. So for several years, there was a good relationship between the white man and the Native American. But after the Revolutionary War, as more and more immigrants came into this area, they kept pushing the Native Americans further and further off the homeland. Until the end of the 1700s and the beginning of the 1800s, conflicts arose. And in that ended in 1813, 1814, what we call the Creek Indian War. And then from 1837 to 1840, the government then rounded up all the Native Americans in the Southeast and moved them to Oklahoma, which we know is the Trail of Tears.
Rank and social status were very important to Mississippians. 47 seats line a slightly raised perimeter bench. Three more seats, including the chief seat, were molded into the base of the bird effigy platform. The Mississippians were sky watchers and were keenly aware of the solstices and equinoxes. The four pillars that once supported the timbered roof are aligned in the cardinal directions, north, south, and east, west. In a sense, the Earth Lodge also told time. A long tunnel, running exactly east-west, linked the Earth Lodge with the outside world. At sunrise, on only 2 days each year, February 22nd and October 22nd, a shaft of light sweeps directly over the central fire and illuminates the chief's seat. We can only imagine what ceremonials were held here, what rituals were played out.